welcome to all of you as we gather together again for worship on this eighth Sunday after Pentecost, and we're continuing our series, Healing Racial Divides in America. The theme of this week will be, What Can I Do? As we kind of examine those things. 1 Peter 4, 7 through 11, What Can I Do? And here's the thing, though. Here's what God has done for us. This is our baptismal font. He's adopted us into his family. He's washed us. He's placed his name upon us. And he says, you're my child. You've been drowned with Christ, but you've been raised to newness of life in Christ. So when we come into worship, it is about what God has done initially. God is the one who has acted on our behalf. And our worship is just us reflecting and rising up on what he has done as we praise him for all he has done for us, the salvation he's brought to us in and through Jesus Christ. So please stand, and we make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And gracious Father, thank you so much for joining us with you in our baptism, that you have placed your name upon us, that we're held in your everlasting loving arms, that we can never, ever be separated from you, but that you love us now and for all eternity in and through what Jesus Christ has done for us, your one and only Son. We pray this in his mighty name. Amen.
If my heart is overwhelmed and I cannot hear your voice, I'll hold on to what is true, though I cannot see. If the storms of life they come and the road ahead gets steep, I will lift these hands in faith. I will believe. I remind myself of all that you've done, and the life I have because of your Son. Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. I am yours. I am forever yours.
And the life I have.
I felt fire from above. I've been down to the river. I'm the same prodigal return. All my hope is in Jesus. Thank God that yesterday's gone. All my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. I'm no stranger to prison. I've worn shackles and chains, but I've been freed and forgiven. I'm not going back, I'll never be the same. All my hope is in Jesus. Thank God that yesterday's gone. All my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. There's a kind of thing that just breaks a man. Bring him down to his knees. But I've been broken more than a time or two. Then pick me up and show me what it means to be a man. All my hope is in Jesus. Thank God that yesterday's gone. All my sins are forgiven. I've been by the blood. All my hope is in Jesus. Thank God that yesterday's gone. All my sins are forgiven. Oh, I've been washed by the blood. Oh, I've been washed by the blood.
Good morning. Our first reading comes from 1 Kings chapter 3, verses 5 through 9. 1 Kings chapter 3, verses 5 through 9. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I shall give you." And Solomon said, You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant David, my father, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love, and have given him a son to sit on his throne this day. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of David my father, although I am but a little child. I do not know how to go out or to come in. And your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too many to be numbered or counted for multitude. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to govern this, your great people? This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading comes from 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 through 11. 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 through 11. The end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be self-controlled and sober-minded for the sake of your prayers. Above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins. Show hospitality to one another without grumbling. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks as one who speaks oracles of God, whoever serves as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
And thanks be to God.
We stand for the reading of the gospel, the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter, verses 43 to 48. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter, verses 43 to 48. Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? You therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. This is the gospel of the Lord, and thanks be to God. And let's go before the Lord in prayer now. Just a reminder, you can send your prayer requests in to Pastor B. Spang at comcast.net. And again, we just really do count it as a privilege to bring your concerns before God's throne of grace. Also, we like to hear praises as well. The way God is working in your life, the things that God is doing in your life during this time, we'd love to hear that as well. Any praise reports that you have. So let's go before God's throne of grace. Father God, we come into your presence, thankful for this time together, thankful for the work that you have done in our lives, what you have done for us, all of us, that we haven't earned it or deserved it, but you have done it that we may have life and have life abundantly. Lord God, use us as your instruments, that you would show us the way to use the gifts, the talents, the treasures that you have given to us, empowered by the Holy Spirit, to be a blessing to other people, to help to bring about racial reconciliation in this nation. We lift that before you. We pray, Lord God, that we would humble ourselves and submit ourselves to you, that revival, if it's going to come to this nation, will start with each of us repenting, turning to you, humbling ourselves before, and bringing about reconciliation within the church, first and foremost. And then, Lord God, outside of the walls of the church to the wider community, Lord God, help us to be a blessing. And Father God, we pray that in the midst of everything that's going on, that our love would not grow cold, that our hearts would not be hardened, that your peace would rest upon us, and that as your peace rests upon us through the working and power of your Spirit, you would help us to love others well as you have loved us. I pray for your blessing upon each and every person that is hearing this and joining us for worship this day. You know their hearts. You know where they're at in their relationship with you. I pray for any who are wrestling with questions and doubts, that they would be brave enough to ask those questions, to wrestle with those things, that they would open up, and I'd pray that they would know that they have a place that they can come, questions that they can ask to me or to others in the church, and that we're open to hearing those questions and to trying to respond as best as we can and to loving people well. Help us, Lord God, to do that together. And Lord God, again, that people would be open and honest with the struggles that they have in their life, and that we would be there for each other to walk each other through these things, to walk alongside one another. So Lord God, we praise you and thank you. Praise you and thank you for all that you have done for us. In the mighty, mighty name of your one and only Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who's taught us to pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
You are
Spirit upon the broken.
Continuing our sermon series on healing racial divides in America. And today we're going to take a look at what can I do? What can I do in the midst of all of this? Based on a reading from 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 through 11. 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 through 11. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Father, we come in your presence thankful for this day. Thankful for grace in our life, your grace in our lives. Thankful, Lord God, that you allow us to partner with you in the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Teach us now from your word, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So what can I do? That's really a tough question. So I'm going to tell you a little story. When I was in sixth grade, I think I was going into sixth grade, I went to a camp, summer camp, called Camp Conrad Weiser. And I went there for 2 weeks, 2 weeks of camping. And in that camp, they had the boys, you know, separated off by different age groups. So I was with the sixth grade guys. And you went into different clusters in which you had the people that stayed in your particular kind of a pavilion-like structure. So you slept in there. It was open to the air. On the sides, you had a roof over your head so you wouldn't get rained on or anything. And they had cots in there, and you put your sleeping bag on that. And that's where you slept for those 2 weeks. So I can't imagine what the sleeping bags smelled like after sixth grade boys were sleeping in them for outside for 2 weeks. But anyway, that's what we did. I don't know who thought it would be a good idea to cluster a bunch of sixth grade boys together for 2 weeks. And also to have them being counseled by college age guys who were just looking for a summer job to kind of keep busy with at that time. So one of the nights, each of the groups would get to backpack up a mountain that was nearby and kind of have more of a wilderness experience, since we didn't have enough experience sleeping outside, since we were sleeping outside anyway. But now this was really under no shelter whatsoever, but you hiked up a nearby mountain and slept there. So our counselor, when we went to that place, had this brilliant idea of having us bushwhack after we got to our campsite and set up camp there, bushwhack down the side of the mountain through the woods, crossing several fields, then crossing a few more miles to get to a drive-in movie theater, where he then had us sneak over the back fence of the new movie theater and lay flat on the ground in the back of the drive-in movie theater so we could watch the movie that was playing. I still remember the movie. It was The Sting, that was playing. I think I fell asleep through most of it. And then when the movie was over at some ungodly hour, we got up and started to try to make our way back to the camp around midnight in the pitch dark. Somehow we did actually make it back to that camp and got a little bit of sleep that night. So needless to say, finding our way back was a challenge. So in the midst of all of this, during those 2 weeks, I remember a lot of scuffles would take place. Fights of varying degrees were pretty common. In sixth grade, there tends to start to be a fairly wide distribution of heights among sixth grade boys. Some are maturing faster, others are still just little tiny guys as well. So there's this big disparity in size of guys. Well, some of the bigger guys decided to get together, a cluster of people, and decided it was a good idea to chase down a victim and give them a wedgie. Now, if you don't know what a wedgie is, it was the picking somebody up by their grabbing their underwear and picking them up off the ground by their underwear. Not very comfortable. Well, these guys chased down somebody who was a friend of mine. And my anger built as they chased down this friend of mine. Oh, by the way, did I mention I wasn't one of the big guys? I was a scrawny little guy, but I had this going for me. I could run really, really fast. So as they chased down a friend of mine and my anger grew, I spewed out some choice words at these guys that were doing this. And to my horror, they all turned in unison and looked at me and they said, "Let's get that guy." And they started chasing me. And I ran like the wind, like my life depended on it, because my life did depend on it. And they didn't catch me. But that kind of stuck with me for a number of reasons. So, you know, this was just the result of all that was going on in this camp and the dysfunction that was there. And while they didn't catch me then, and I didn't like what they were doing to my friend, it's sad to say to you, I bullied people at times in my life. We didn't even call it bullying back then. I don't know what we called it. Just picking on somebody, I don't know what it was called back then. But I did my part of bullying, but I always had a anger, and it just really kind of got me riled up when a group of guys would pick on someone that was much weaker than them. So I had a disdain for injustice, if you will. My one man stand towards that injustice that was occurring and calling out those sixth grade punks didn't do anything to bring about peace in the camp. The reason I'm telling you that story is because I believe there are many people who are angry at injustices that have occurred, are occurring in our society, or have occurred in the past in our society. And they are reacting in anger. They're angry about it, they're reacting in anger. I see a lot of anger. Anger at injustices, anger at police, anger at politicians, anger at our past. Anger, however, is never a good recipe for reconciliation. Let me ask you this, if you're married, how often has anger towards your spouse resulted in reconciliation? If you have a friend and some way you were hurt, how often has anger towards your friend resulted in any kind of reconciliation? Why would we expect anger to work as a recipe for bringing about reconciliation in our society for the wrongs that have occurred? Yet what I see on TV and on social media is many times dripping with anger, permeating with anger. So what can I do in the midst of this sea of anger? Well, I think what's important for all of us who call ourselves followers of Jesus is to actually see what God's word says and to put that into practice in our life. So I want to dig into the words of the Apostle Peter from 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 through 11, and see how they apply to our life right here, right now, with what we're going through. So 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7, Peter starts off in saying, the end of all things is near, is at hand. So nobody knows the day or the hour of Jesus' return, but I am confident about this, that we're closer to the day and the hour of Jesus' return than when Peter said these words. But what was Peter getting at when he said, the end of all things is at hand? Well, one of the things I think we can be certain of is that for all of us, we don't personally know how much time we have on this earth. And even if we live a full, long life, it is very short in comparison with eternity. So our time on this earth is short. Not only that, the end of all things is at hand. If you think about our lives, many times what seems to be pressing at the moment, we don't even remember what was pressing at the moment 6 months from now. We might not even remember what's pressing at the moment a week from now. So when we're saying the end of all things at our hand, keep a perspective. Keep an eternal perspective. Keep an idea that your time on this earth is short. And also what is happening today, what is pressing today, may not be the thing that is pressing a month from now, 6 months from now. He says, therefore, Peter goes on to say, therefore be self-controlled and sober-minded for the sake of your prayers. So if we have a right perspective, an eternal perspective on things, then I can start to control my body. He says to be self-controlled. And if I'm not self-controlled, and I'm not sober-minded, and if I'm flailing about, and if my mind is filled with anxiety and anger and all these other things that are in there, then what is my prayer life going to be like? How can I possibly seek the Lord's will in the midst of the chaos when I'm a part of the chaos? And so he says to us and reminds us, if my body and my mind is filled with anger and anxiety and bitterness and hatred, what in the world would my prayer life be like? Can I really seek the Lord and his wisdom and guidance in his peace and a way forward if I'm filled with bitterness and anger and strife and anxiety? So he says, be self-controlled, sober-minded. And he's reminding us, I believe here, that in the battles of life, they ultimately are spiritual. And that if we think we're going to solve the battles of life by our own strength, by our own flailing about, we're kidding ourselves. That racial reconciliation is ultimately a spiritual battle in which we have to engage with the enemy at a spiritual level. And that means to be on our knees in prayer. That means to be seeking God with all of our heart, mind, and spirit. That means to be humbling ourselves before him and to recognizing that we're not gonna be of any value, any assistance in bringing about peace and reconciliation if we think we're gonna do it via our own strength and our own discernment and wisdom. This is a spiritual battle that we're in, and our prayer life should reflect that. He goes on to say this, Peter says this, above all, keep loving each other another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins. So instead of yelling at each other across barriers, we got lots of barriers we can do. Sometimes you see on news like the actual physical barriers that they have up and people screaming at each other over physical barriers that they have up. But we can put our barriers of, of social media up so that we feel that we can have free rein to yell at somebody and put somebody down just because we have this distance of the internet. It's not like a real person we're talking to. Well, yes, it is a real person that we are engaging with. So instead of yelling at each other across these barriers, maybe we could actually put the words of Jesus into practice when Jesus ate with sinners. There's a lot of mistrust out there that really prevents us from crossing those barriers. And wherever there's mistrust, then we tend to go back to our own little groups that we're comfortable with, own little place that we are really feel that comfort because we're people with that think like us and have the same beliefs, political spectrum, and all this other stuff. So whatever we're comfortable with. Now, what if someone, instead of yelling, I've seen videos of this, it's very disturbing, the things that are going on, the yelling, and there's many examples I could use, but somebody like right in a police officer's face, screaming at them about being a no good racist blankety blank, whatever they want to fill that in with. Instead of doing that, actually invited the police officer to breakfast, to pay for their breakfast, and hear the struggles that they are facing trying to do their job in this environment. Can't be easy. What if white people, instead of posting articles by black people who agree with their particular position on these things, instead of posting those articles of someone you don't know but just happens to agree with you on the position that you want to take, instead of doing that, to actually inviting an African American to sit down with them, to have them over for dinner, to have coffee with them, whatever, to just start to have a conversation, to get to know them. What if we had our African American neighbor over, someone real flesh and blood, instead of people we don't know? What if it's a fellow congregant? So maybe, just maybe, if we were doing something along those lines, we would realize how much our desires, our hopes for the future, align in so many ways. That there's really not nearly as much division as we would like to think. That their hopes and desires are the same as our hopes and desires. To earnestly love, as Peter is saying, he's saying earnestly love, that means to be persistent in our love. That means that it is ongoing. That it means that it is proactive. That means that we have to stick it out, to really work hard, to work at our relationships. I mean, the same, we know these things to be true in our friendships. We know these things to be true in our marriages. You have to work at it. So the same would be true for racial reconciliation. You have to work at it. This church has to be proactive in actually working at it. Peter goes on to say this: show hospitality to one another without grumbling. Now, granted, with the ongoing pandemic, things can be challenging for us to get together. You know, maybe it's challenging to have somebody over your house for dinner right now. I don't know. It depends on what you would do. Maybe you had the dinner outside, socially distanced. I know it's a little bit challenging right now. But what about having a campfire in your backyard, socially distanced? What about enjoying some snacks or s'mores around the campfire? Hey, I would guess this. S'mores cooked on a campfire would do more to bring about understanding each other than any like really grandiose plan that we could put together. Just cook some s'mores together around a campfire and talk to each other. Peter says this: as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks is one who speaks oracles of God. Whoever serves is one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. All of you have been given gifts from God. All of you have been given the gift of faith. Those of you who trust in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you have the gift of faith that has been given to you. But not only that, you have the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit, the creator of the universe, indwelling power of the Holy Spirit, who has gifted you with exactly the gifts that are needed to do what Jesus has called his church to do, to go and proclaim the good news to all people. The Holy Spirit empowers you to speak God's healing words and strength to serve others. Satan wants a divided church, a segregated church, a church where people mistrust each other. Why? Because Satan knows that undermines the gospel. He knows that. And he knows that if the church grabs hold of the gospel, really grabs hold of the gospel, that he cannot stand against that. That he surely has been defeated. He's already been defeated on the cross. And the church grabs hold of the completed work of Jesus Christ, the gospel of Jesus Christ, that Satan cannot stand against it. He has no power to resist that. The time on earth, is this time that we have, is not about you and me. It's about Christ. It's not about holding on to our grievances. It's not about holding on to our pride where we can't admit that we've done something wrong, or we just want to bury our heads in the sand about things that we may have been a part of, or biases we may have. It is not about holding on to fear. Fear separates us. Fear divides us into camps. We'll only be with the people we're comfortable with. It's about Jesus and what he has done for all people. There is a sign that I occasionally see when I'm driving around, whether it's in a neighborhood or wherever it might be. It says, no justice, no peace. What if Jesus had that attitude? Hey man, I don't see justice for me. There ain't going to be any peace. Think we might be putting up barriers when we act in that way? What are you striving for in the midst of all of this that is going on? What would you like to see happen? I hope it's not just, let's get past this and move on. What is God calling you to in the midst of this? Would you have peace? Do you desire that? What are you striving for? What is driving you in the midst of this? What about instead of no justice, no peace, that what was driving us is no Jesus, no peace, K-N-O-W, no Jesus, K-N-O-W, no peace. What if that was driving us? What can I do in the midst of all this? Know Jesus more and more. The gift of his grace, the gift of his forgiveness, the gift of what he has done for me. Because it all starts with him, and it ends with him. What he has done for us. It's not so much what I can do, what he has done for you, what he has done for me. So I need to know, I want to know Jesus more and more. And when I know him more and more, then I can be used by him in a way that makes him known, the Prince of Peace, to others. That may seem small and insignificant in the midst of everything that's going on. But I tell you this, that's what turned the Roman Empire upside down. That's what will turn the society upside down, one person at a time. We're in it for the long haul. The church has the answer in the midst of all this. that as we know Jesus, K-N-O-W, we know his grace, we know his forgiveness, we know his love, we know how deeply he loves us more and more, then we will know peace and we will be agents of peace in the midst of all the chaos that is going on around us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for your grace in our lives. Let's pray. Thank you that you have been so patient and long-suffering with us. That you did not take the attitude that, hey, if I don't see justice for myself, nobody else is going to have peace. Instead, you gave everything that we may have peace. Peace with our Heavenly Father. And yes, your desire is that we have peace and unity with one another as well. So now, Lord God, as we go forth from here, send us forth, not in our own strength, Lord God, with what am I going to do to change the world, but what you have done to change me. What you have already done for us. And to make that known to others. Help us, Lord God, to bring healing to this nation through the blood, power, mercy, grace, love, and forgiveness of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Let us confess together our faith in the triune God and all he has done for us. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We're having a time of confession before the Lord. And the Lord knows what's really on our heart, but what he's inviting us to do is come before him, be honest before him, come into his presence. Don't hide anything from him, run to him. It's a mistake for us to run from God. We should run towards him and confess to him. So let's open our hearts and our minds to him. There'll be a time of silence as well that we can really pour out our hearts to God. So from the words from 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 and 9, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's take a moment in silence to reflect upon our need for Christ. So Lord, let us confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. But for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Hear the good news. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the gift of the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us,
Bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
All right. Well, thank you so much for joining us for worship this day. I think a challenge for all of us is this week is to really pray about what is God calling each and every one of us to do by his grace, through the relationship you have with Jesus Christ. What is he calling you to do to be a healing agent in this nation right now? And when I say nation, you know, that's a big, big word. A lot of, you know, 330 million people or whatever in the United States. But I think it starts with each and every one of us really heeding the call of the Holy Spirit in our lives to bring about peace and reconciliation with the people that God has placed in our lives. So I really want you to pray about that this week as you go forth. So I want to send you forth, knowing you're not doing this in your own strength, but in the strength and the power of the Lord God Almighty. And so may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you, be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.